John chapter 10, verse 10. Will be our opening text. Keep your Bibles out, because I told Barney, I said, I'm not going to give you all the verses this morning, because people get used to seeing them up on the screen. Y'all stop bringing your Bibles to church. You ought to always bring your Bibles. My goodness. You know, I got two boys been over to Afghanistan and Iraq and stuff, fighting and everything, and the only pictures you get of them without a helmet and all this other stuff on them is when they're up in their... They're in a base, and they're up between these big old metal buildings and stuff, their barracks areas, and nobody can get to them and shoot them and stuff. But when they walk outside of that gate, they got body armor on and helmets and all this stuff, and they're in up-armored vehicles and so forth. And I guarantee you, one thing they always have with them is their weapon. So you can't go running around without your sword. You need your Bible. You need your Bible. So John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. That's Jesus talking. Father, we thank you for the text this morning. That Lord God will talk about the abundant life and your will and your way in our life. So Lord God, use this and apply it as you will to our life. Use the Holy Spirit, open up our understanding, Father, so that we know your way. Lord, we thank you and we praise your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I want to talk to you to start with about why aging isn't bad. Getting old, it's not a bad thing. You see, there's a lot of good things about getting old. But, first of all, kidnappers are not so interested in you anymore. Your secrets are pretty safe because your friends can't remember. People, they don't look at you as a hypochondriac anymore, because usually you need the medicine now. No one expects you to run into a burning building anymore. You're not expected to be the hero. Nothing is left to be learned the hard way. You've pretty well gone through those lessons. And your joints are more accurate than the weather service. Getting old is not all bad. There's a lot of good things about getting old. One of the best things is that you didn't die young. Okay? You can have that abundant life and all these changes and things we experience as we get a little older are all... Part of growing old, okay, our memory going, that's an effect of sin, that's not God. Our joints hurting, we're in a world of sin and it affects things. All the things that we sit here and I have a saying, it's old age isn't for sissies. You got to be tough to get old. The things you go through, but this life God has for us is intended to be abundant. And so I want to talk to you about abundant life. It's not limited. It's abundant life is not things, but your reaction to things. Okay? Abundant life is not things you accumulate. An abundant life is your reaction to the things in your life, the happenings and the events to your life. Things that shake some people will not rock the boat of people with an abundant life. When you look at the parables Jesus taught us from, you see that everybody has problems of some kind. Through those problems, some people are shaken, but they're not ruined. You do things the way the world does them. You do things the way most people will counsel you to do them, the way of the world, you probably will not experience an abundant life. Doing the Word in the way God wants you to do it, to live it, to experience it, to apply it, is the way to abundant life. Randall, I don't want to embarrass embarrass you, but I'm going to use you as an illustration this morning. Okay? Come in this morning, and I shake their hands, and I look at him, and he looked a little bit unsettled. And then I said something about that, didn't I?
That's good.
What's going on? And Judy said, well, he's going to have surgery next week. So that's how I found out. Unless he's prayed for, how is God going to heal him?
Amen.
Now he's a reserved individual. Some people call him shy. He don't like getting in front. And I said, if you allow us to lay hands on you and pray, I won't make you talk. I'm not trying to embarrass anybody, but if he's hurting, I want him well. I want God to touch him. I want a miracle in his life. That's what I want.
Yes.
But do you believe God can heal you? And he goes, yes, absolutely. Well, then good. We're in agreement. And that's one of the things about abundant life is, one, believing God can do something instead of just leaving you in the situation to fight your way through it and live through the consequences of what this world has put on you. When we called for the people to line up down here for those four different things that we were praying for, and Brother Carlton was standing there, and he said he wanted the pain to go away. He wanted to get off the medication that he was on. One of the things I asked every person that was in that line, do you believe God can do this? And I wanted them to say yes. Can we agree together that God's going to do this? You got to believe. You got to agree. You got to ask in Jesus' name. The abundant life. You drift through life and you can cross your arms and say, preacher, I ain't going to do that kind of stuff. That's what a bunch of Pentecostals would do and so forth. No. Christianity came along before the Pentecostals started their movement.
That's right.
God was healing in the Baptist church before Azusa Street started. It's a sad thing that we start withdrawing from God because of the way somebody else wants to act or apply or behave. What we're supposed to do is not back up from God. We're supposed to apply God's word and do it the way God wants us to do it and not hang our head in shame that we're acting funny. God said he wants you to become a peculiar people. A peculiar people will call your brother down here and pray that veins and arteries are cleared out. A peculiar people will lay hands and say, Lord, don't let her go under that surgery. Reduce the aneurysm. Heal her in the name. That's a weird group of people. Then once we see God do these things, we're supposed to testify and tell people of what God did. You don't run around and go, my preacher called this lady down and we laid hands on her and he put olive oil on her head and we prayed over her and my preacher healed. No, no, no. Your preacher didn't do nothing. Okay? God did what was done. God healed her. And that's what we talk about. God healed. God healed. God healed. Churches stop growing because people start talking about their preacher so much. Churches, people don't get saved because they start talking about their programs and their preachers and those ways so much. And that's not what God said. He said, go out in his word. Go out in the highways and hedges and compel them to come in to my house that it might be full. And everywhere Valerie and I have worked, and the people go out in the highways and hedges and compel them. Yeah, you pester them on Saturday morning. You pester them on Saturday afternoon. You pester them on Thursday afternoon. If you want to call it pestering, call them pestering. I don't really care. You contact them. You love them. You let them know we missed you, that we wished you was in Sunday school. And when that happens, we see marvelous things happening. We see churches with just a few handful of people coming in, going to 300 people, 600 people and things. And praise God. You know, as a preacher, we can't hold 300 people. We can hold about 180, though. And two services would be 360. And three services just added up. All you got to do is come to one, right? I got to be at all three of them. Barney might have to be at all three of them. Gene might have to come to all three of them. But... not a big thing. He said, now, I ain't coming to no three services. Well, yeah, you only got to come to the Sunday morning service there. And what if we only have two Sunday evenings? So you only got to come to one of them. Praise God, just wear me out, right? But talk about what God's doing. Go out in highways and hedges and compel them to come in that my house might be full. And then Jesus didn't say, talk about your preacher. Talk about how he preaches. Talk about the stupid stuff he does. The way he's smearing somebody's head with olive oil and praying stuff and asking in Jesus' name. That they, no, no, no. You talk about what somebody was hurt and they need and this thing happened and the doctor said and then what God did and how he changed the course of things. And you can start, see, that's the abundant life. It ain't your preacher. It ain't the way he preaches. It ain't your programs at your church. It's Jesus.
That's right. Amen.
That's what you talk about. Because Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Ministry is meeting people's needs, and everybody needs Jesus. Ministry is breaking the gospel out to somebody that never heard it to where they understand that Jesus isn't just the end of your life. Well, I got born again, so that's the end. No, you got born again. That would indicate that's a beginning, isn't it?
Yes.
It's not over when you get saved. It just got started. You got things. You got what Jesus, the abundant life. You got something more than just the end of something. I didn't just get saved and so now I'm a Christian and I can't have fun. No, I can have more fun than I've ever had because now I'm walking in freedom and liberty. And you go, well, I can't go to the bars anymore, preacher. I don't got to worry about going to the bars if I'm walking in the Spirit, because if I'm walking in the Spirit, I don't have the desire for the bar. You see? It's not a list of do's and don'ts and rules. It's freedom. In the Spirit of God, I don't need... Wouldn't it be nice to have a life, that, an abundant life, that you don't have to dull your senses to get past your problems? But by the mighty hand of God, He starts resolving your problems. That way, there's no hangover, and the problem's not still sitting there after the hangover's over, but the problem is removed. Now you give anybody with average intelligence that choice. You can take this substance into your body. It'll give you a buzz or change your thinking to where you forget your problem while you're on this stuff. The moment you come off the stuff, the problem's going to be gone. I mean, still there. The problem will still be sitting there. You're still going to have it in your life. Your head or your body will be aching. Your pocketbook is going to be lighter than it was. Yeah. Or would you rather Jesus remove the mountain? Get rid of the problem. The abundant life would move the mountain. The world says, drink this, you need a break. You got so much on you, you need to de-stress. Take this, drink that, snort this. Put this in your body. That's what the world says.
Yeah.
And look, that makes some sense, doesn't it? I'm in the physical, I'm going to take something physically to get me past this problem. Now some of y'all religious guys that are much smarter or religious than me, y'all might not agree with me, but it's the truth anyway. Taking things like that makes sense. Praying that God removes it out of your life doesn't make sense. The Bible says that those that don't know the Spirit count that stuff as foolishness. But it works.
It does, amen.
I don't know about the 2 million people who were up against the Red Sea and the Egyptian army coming down in there and they're leaving. Now you think about this. They went down and dunked his staff down into the sea, right? He should have been running back the other, picking it up like a club, ready to knock somebody off a chariot. But he ran down to the ocean and put his pole in the water. And God blew the water back and dried it up and protected them with a pillar of fire while they passed over and stopped. See, that's foolishness. Which would you rather have, the abundant life, or do you want to go through the battle? 75% of those that hear the word do not do the word. 73/4 of the people that hear God's word and hear a message and so forth, they don't apply it. And so I pray and pray, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, come through and blow across the people and apply this message into their lives. That, Lord God, when they leave here, they've been changed, and apply that into their lives so they benefit from it. But if we walk in the light as he is the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin.
Yes.
I've seen people after the service, after the invitation, sitting and crying, and they're broken, and tears are going down their eyes. And you go and you say, "What's going on? What is there anything I can do to help you?" I need help. I need help. What do you need help with? I need a change. I'm ready to let this stuff go. What stuff? This life. I got it. It ain't right. I need God. I need Jesus. I need this weight off of me. It's about to crush me. I need it all. Ask Jesus into their heart and allow God to come in and change their lives, and that weight comes off. So let's look at some hindrances, things that stop you from having this abundant life this morning, if you were. The first thing is disobedience. Like I said, 75% of the people that hear the word don't apply the word. They hear it, but then they won't do the simple thing. Moses, go on down to the ocean, put your staff in there. That wasn't a big thing for him to do. Wasn't something hard. That was something he could do. It's just plain old disobedience. Go do this. If there be any sick among you, you let them call for the elders of the church. Let them lay hands on you, anoint your head. Pray the prayer of faith. And they'll recover and their sins be forgiven. People always forget that last little bit. God's always interested in your sins. See? I mean, he wants the physical part done too, but he's also interested in, and probably more interested in, the sin side of things. Over in Jonah, the first chapter, y'all know it. The Lord came to Jonah and said, "Jonah, go on down to Nineveh. Jonah, go on down to Nineveh. That group of Gentiles down there. Okay? And I want you to declare the word of the Lord to the Gentiles." See, way back in the Old Testament, God was still interested in the Gentiles. Everybody thought it was always the Jews, the Jews, the Jews. But even then, the old people down in Nineveh, they were the Gentiles. And Jonah, "I'm not sharing the gospel with those guys down there. They're not Jewish, they're Gentiles, God." And it says that he went and he found a ship going over to Tarsus. And he paid the fare. He paid the price. Let me tell you what. Sin will take you where you don't want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay there, and cost you more than what you intended to pay.
Right. Yep.
And old Jonah pulled money that he probably couldn't afford out of his pocket to pay a ticket to go over to the east when he was supposed to be going over to the west. He went the opposite direction God wanted. He was disobedient to God. And that storm came up. He knew he was on board. He knew he was disobedient to God. And even the pagans, the old sailors that were on that ship, when he said, "I'm the reason that God brought you in this storm, you throw me overboard, and God will honor you. Even though you don't know him, you don't serve him, you don't praise him, you get rid of your problem, man, and God will straighten this out." They jumped him over. Even the world don't want a problem Christian. Even the world don't want a disobedient Christian. It causes problems. And I've taught y'all this. Your sin's not just yours. When you sin, you affect not only your relationship to God, but your relationship to everybody around you and all of nature. Look what happened in Genesis whenever Adam and Eve sinned. All of a sudden, their relationship with each other were all messed up. They had to get leaves and put on clothes and stuff. Their relationship Adam and Eve between themselves, it was messed up. Their relationship with God was all disrupted. They hid from Him where they were waiting every afternoon to fellowship and spend time with God walking through the garden. But not only that, it disrupted their relationship with nature. Can you imagine that first time when God came down and had that conversation and they admitted they had sinned and He called for an animal and that old lamb had to come up to God, trusting? Death had never entered into anything. And God took that animal and slew it to take the skins to cover up their sins. Their sins affected all of nature. It messed with their relationship with each other. It messed up with their relationship with God. And it messed up their relationship with everything around them, all of nature. All of creation was disturbed because of their sin. And your sin does exactly the same thing. And when Jonah went over there to Tarshish, it messed up his relationship with God. It messed up his relationship with all of nature. God had to create and prepare a big fish to swallow him up. Things had to get changed to handle Jonah's life, okay, of his life of sin. And those old sailors on board that boat, you know those weren't good people. You know they weren't saved. You know they weren't following God. And they wouldn't even put up with that old corrupt Christian. You cannot experience the abundant life if you bow your neck and do your own thing. You bow your neck and God has sent pastors and He has put it in His Word and He has put it on TV and He has put it in Sunday school and He has put it in your quarterlies and He has made songs about it and all these things about the way you live and praise God and lift Him up and exalt Him and give testimonies and these things applied to your life and you bow your back and you become disobedient. You cannot experience the abundance of life if you're bowing your neck or being stiff-necked, as the Bible would call it. But after all that, Jonah went down in chapter 2, verse 9, and it says, But I'm going to sacrifice to you now, O God, with a voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. He's sitting there with fish puke all over him up on the beach, and God saved his life after being in the belly of that great fish all that time. And he said, I'll pay what I owe now. Being disobedient has a price. But he was praising God. Chapter 2, verse 9. He was praising God. He was lifting up. He was exalting God.
Yes.
You know why Jonah was praising Him? He said, I'll go over to Nineveh. I'll do what you say, Lord. Because God gave him a second chance. Bless God.
Yes,
praise God. He gave him a second chance. And God will give you a second chance. God will give you the chance, if you'll turn your ear, if you'll put your eyes on Him, God will give you a second chance. Disobedience is one of the reasons why you don't experience the abundant life. Another reason why abundance life doesn't always come into your life, believe it or not, is sometimes you're doing the work of God. Mark 4:35. Start saying, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, Jesus was talking to his disciples, let's cross over to the other side. Let's go over across that sea. Mark 4:35. Now when they had left the multitude of people, they took him along in the boat as he was, and the other little boats were also with him. So he and a bunch of other boats started going across the sea. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. It was about to sink. Now they were right in the middle of God's will. Jesus was with them. They were doing the Word. Problems are going to come even when you're doing the Word of God, doing the Word. But let me tell you what, the bigger the future ministry, the bigger the problems you're going to face. I told a number of people here, told Valerie, I said, I feel like God's fixing to bring another surge over here to the church. I think we're going to get, lo and behold, last week, three people got gloriously saved. Okay.
Yes.
We're going to have a baptism and service shortly. Okay? And we're going to celebrate some things. Now, after something almost every week happening here for over a year, year and a half, God kind of cooled things off. You know why God cooled things off? Is some of us got cool. Some of us went cold. Okay? But that surge, that refreshing thing started coming again. And last week we had three accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Got gloriously saved. And we celebrate all those things. And I look forward to what else God's going to do. But when I told Valerie and some of the, Carl, I think I shared it with you. Dwight, I think I shared it with you. Matt, he's not here, but I shared it with him. That along with this surge, this new thing God's going to kind of get going again and blessing us with people and so forth again. As he does that, I said, we're going to be in a battle. We're going to be in a battle. How many of y'all think that God wanted to kill these people crossing the Sea of Galilee? God didn't want to kill them. And you go, well, preacher, God had to allow it or the storm wouldn't have come up. Yeah. How many of y'all have ever had anything bad happen in your life? If something bad's ever happened in your life, raise your hand. The devil did that. The devil did that. And y'all play those games with him. God had to allow it, preacher. Well, don't accuse God of doing the bad thing. Is he all powerful? Yeah. But sometimes he allows the devil to put something into your life, like a storm, so that he can beat it. Maybe your storm's cancer. God can beat it. Maybe it's an aneurysm, but God can beat it. Maybe it's something else. God can beat it. The worst thing that's ever happened in my life is losing Charnel, my baby daughter. Having to stand up in front of people and preach her funeral. That was a hard thing to do. Anybody loses a child. My heart goes out to them. I've gone through that. But God didn't kill my baby. God brought her home. God brought my baby home. And somewhere in his bookkeeping system is my name's written up there. My baby's up there. My mama's up there. My daddy's up there. My great aunt's up there. My grandpa's up there. And he's been accumulating more of my life on that side. And one day that old balance is going to tilt over to the heaven side. And he says, well, Steve, I got more of you up here than you got down there. Come on, y'all.
Yeah, amen. Yes.
Come on, God. Put your finger on the scale. That's okay. I'm ready.
Amen.
Those aren't bad things. You see, I'm walking with the abundant life. To have confidence in him. That even with death, things are better. And that's what Paul taught us. Sometimes you're doing the word and there's trouble that comes into your life. But sometimes it's problems or hindrances in your abundant life. You see, people that you're connected with sometimes will cause that abundant life, that joy to just kind of ebb out and not be so evident in your life. You hanging around people that are always pulling you down, always talking against church, always talking about the leadership, always talking, well, they ain't doing that. Well, let me tell you something. The leadership in God's church, God talks to them and guides them, and who are you to question God?
Right.
You can question me. That's okay. If you got a question, you got a problem with that, you come and talk to me, and I'll let you know what God's telling me. I'll try to share that vision. And I'll try to line that up with God's Word, and it should line up with God's Word and where we're going. Okay? But in 40-something years of pastoring a church and being in the ministry, most of the congregation claim they've never heard or been led of God. That's one reason why on Wednesday night we're teaching knowing and doing the will of God. Because I think it ain't just for preachers, it's for all of us. Y'all getting anything out of Wednesday night?
Yes.
There's something there? Sometimes people come in talking against things. Let me tell you what, I can repent of my own sins, but I can't repent of your sins. I can't get your problems out of God's way so he can bless you. I can only get problems out of my life and say, Lord, forgive me. And I'll guarantee you, every pastor I know that's worth anything has laid down on the altar and got crying and snotting all over the place, and it's all quiet and everything, and just him and God getting things straightened out. And more of our people would get. This is a term that some of y'all have probably never heard, praying through. Okay? Hitting the altar and staying there and laying before God until God changes. Until you pray through. It's over with. The problem's gone. I'm marching forward. You ain't going to stop me no more, devil. I got my answer. I know it. God's always been God, but maybe I'm too slow to catch it quick enough. Praying through. Get the right people around you. People that pull you down, pull you off base, complaining about what the church is doing, that things aren't doing right. Why are they doing that? Why can't I do this? I've never told people they can't do something in ministry. Yesterday at the hospital, Kaylee's sitting there. I go, when are you going to sing for us again? Praise God, that little girl came from that pew, that third pew back, right over there. I tell you, she was like three people in. And she got touched by God, and she came down and got gloriously saved. We baptized her and everything. Lives over there in Tifton. Not easy for her to be over here. Her grandpa has to go and get her and make arrangements and then get her back home and all that kind of stuff. It's a little bit of an effort and so forth. But praise God, she gets picked up with a bus all the time, goes to church, she sings all the time over there now, and so forth. But she sang Jesus Take the Wheel for us with three other little girls one time up here. Did such a marvelous job. Didn't have an accompaniment CD or nothing to go with it. And I said, I got the CD. I got the music for you if you want to sing it. So we got them up here this morning, the two of them. Praise God, they sang. Exercising that youth and everything, letting them get up there and do marvelous things. We have to be the kind of people that encourage these children to serve God. Okay? But it's scary. It's scary to stand up here and do this kind of stuff. Okay? It's scary to do that. Y'all come on up here tonight. We'll give you a solo chance. It's scary if you've ever done that. You get up here, and the little girls get up here and they're doing it, and I am so proud of that. But they got to have the right people in their lives. They got people that come by and pick them up to church and bring them to church and love them in Sunday school and teach them, and then get up and bring them back and let them sing and get them in choir and all those kind of things. And we praise God for all those things, but sometimes it's people. You see, the people in your life will bring things into you. Paul, arrested, going over to Rome on a ship. He got into a storm too. Okay? He got into a storm. And the messenger of God came to Paul and said, look, you're surely going to lose the ship tonight, but God is not going to allow anybody to die. And the old prisoner got up in front of all of his captors and the sailors and everything and said, listen, we're going to lose the ship. It's going to go down. But nobody's going to die. God's told me that. So he stood up with the confidence in God. That's a foolish thing. Now back then, they didn't have life jackets and life rafts and all this other stuff. They didn't have signal flares. A ship go down during that in a storm. Back in that day, people died. But Paul stood up and said, not only are we going to lose the ship, God told me that, but nobody's going to die. And they got shipwrecked and ended up on an island, and God gloriously saved every one of them. They heard from the man of God. So he was in the middle of doing God's will. Got arrested. Going to be sent to Rome to stand trial. You think he wanted to go to Rome? Mm-mm. Was he having to do something he didn't really want to do? Yeah. It wasn't convenient to be arrested, being sent to a trial. Sometimes the people in your life, though, bring hardship. Maybe they got to go through the hardship so that they can listen to you. Paul wasn't wrong, they were wrong. But Paul went down with the ship too. He had to experience it. So that those people were trapped on an island with a crazy preacher and hear about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul came back later and said, count it all joy when your life go through different type of troubles and tribulation. Count it all joy when you're shipwrecked. Count it all joy when you're in a storm. Count it all joy when you're beat to death and thrown out on the garbage heap, left for dead. Count it all joy, Paul said. He's the one who got beaten and taunted and abused and shipwrecked and locked up. And he's the one who said, count it all joy when you fall into all these trials. Because it's opportunities. The last point on why we don't have this abundant life sometimes is self-deception. We deceive ourselves. The devil doesn't have anything to do with it. James chapter 1, 22-24 says, But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. People come to church, they read their Bible at home, they tell me time and time again, they struggle with life, and after they get through talking, I say, well, what have you done for the Lord lately? What have you done for the Lord? Well, I don't know what to do. If I only knew what God wanted me to do, I'd go do it. I love Him with all my heart. Well, you're reading His Word, what does it tell you to do? I don't know. What does God want to be done here in Fitzgerald, Georgia? I asked that Wednesday night. Gene, I think he said, he wants to save souls. He wants to save people. Okay? So if we know that's God's will, shouldn't we get in on that? If we're obedient to God, and we're doers of the word and not hearers only, and we know that's God's will, isn't that one of the things we could be about doing? We don't have the abundant life because we've deceived ourselves. I go to church. Every time church doors open, I'm over there. I give some money. I clap when the preacher says clap and all this stuff. No. But James says, but be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. You're looking in a mirror. And it says, look at verse 24, for he looks at himself, he goes away and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. If you're a hearer of the word and doer only, you're like looking in a mirror, seeing your image, and when you turn away, you can't even recognize yourself. It's doing you no good. You don't remember. You can't apply. So it's important that we don't deceive ourselves, James says. It's important that we do the Word of God, not just hear it. You got to overcome with an abundant life. Deuteronomy, Old Testament, I know, but it's still true. Chapter 28, it talks about, now it'll come to pass if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully His commandments, the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth. Listen, and all these blessings. You want the abundant life? All these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you. I want to be overtaken with the blessings of God. Because you obey the voice of God. You'll be overtaken with the blessings of God if you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Blessings in your country, healthy kids, your gardens, your animals, plenty of food, blessing in your coming and your going. That's the abundant life. What if you hear and obey the Word of God? If you apply what God tells you in His Word, that you'll have a blessed town and country. This town needs blessing. This country needs a blessing. Healthy kids and gardens and animals. We're an agricultural area. We're praying for rain. We need a blessing. But we got to obey God. We can't sit down, God, cause it to rain, cause it to rain, cause it to rain, and skip service and skip church. And when I say service, and I'm talking about out there doing what God wants us to do. Service. Ministry. We can't go and ask God, here, take care of all my needs and everything, and then just disregard everything He wants, and it's His plenty of food. That's the kind of God, blessing God wants you to have. You're the one that controls your blessings. God's pouring out blessings. God has a will, and He pours His blessings out around His will. And if you're over here, and His will is over here, you're missing your blessings. You're missing your abundant life. You want the abundant life, you want the blessings of God, you might find it better in the center of His will. As you struggle with your life, do you really think God's going to move His will over to shower down on you? Or do you think God's going to do His blessing and expect you to be obedient and center up with His will? The first thing that God wants is for you to have a relationship with Him, and that's with Jesus Christ. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that's the first step. God's will is that all men be saved. Every one of us. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, everybody needs to be saved. That's God's will. So the first thing to get in God's will is get in Jesus. Get saved. If you're not saved while I'm playing the piano, I'm going to ask that you come down and make a public profession of faith. That's basically just saying, I'm asking God to forgive me of my sins, and I pledge that I'll follow Jesus as my Lord and Savior the rest of my life. It's a commitment. Is there anybody here that's not saved that needs Jesus, that needs to be saved? I'm going to give you that opportunity. Here's God's will. Are you going to get in? You want the abundant life? You got to be in God's will. Will God bless you over here? Yeah, He reigns on the just and the unjust alike. I know that. But His will is the key. You want the abundant life? I don't want the same blessings in my life as some sinner over there that doesn't acknowledge God. If that's all I got, I'm losing out. I want what God wants for me. Are you in the center of God's will? If you've accepted Christ as your Savior and walked away and not focused on Him, maybe you need to come to the altar and get things right and ask God to forgive you for those mistakes and center yourself back on God's will. The altars are open. If you need the altar, here's the altar. You can come down. Center yourself up. Get in God's will. Get into that abundant life. Are any of these things hindering you? You allow people to come in and sway you off course. Oh, there's negative people all around all the time. And they'll pull you off course. It's a crab bucket mentality. If you've ever been crabbing and you get one crab and put them in, you got to put a lid on that thing. But once you get two or three crabs down in there, you can take the lid off. Because every time one of them tries to get up and escape and break loose, the other one's going to reach up, grab them, and pull them back down. They'll sit down and you try to break out for God and they'll reach up and go, no, come on back down. They'll say things and do things that'll just pull you back down. You got to break free. You got to be determined. It takes a commitment to follow God. It's not hard, but it takes a commitment. All the perfect good stuff doesn't just happen unto you. In fact, there's storms. But you'll have stability. My goodness, if I could just have the stability Paul had, and even though I knew the ship was going down, that nobody was going to die, wouldn't that be great? We're going to be okay. That's abundant life. Do you have that? You need the altar. The altars are here. If you're not saved, you need Jesus.